Michelle Wong. It's 9 a.m. in Manila, 10 a.m. in Tokyo, and 11 a.m. in Sydney. The headlines: Wall Street rises as investors cheer the full approval of Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine. Asian stocks all set to mirror those gains. Eurotone Philippine shares looking to rebound after slipping to the 6,500 level at the start of the week. We're going to be speaking with Ken Wong of East Spring Investments for an outlook on Asian markets. Philippine business groups say repeated lockdowns in the country are failing to curb the ongoing spike in COVID-19 cases. And the REIT from the Robinsons Group sets a final offer price for its planned real estate investment trust offering. RL Commercial REIT Chairman Frederick Go joins us later on the show for more on that. We begin with the financial markets. Wall Street kicking off the week on a high note as investors cheer positive news on the COVID-19 vaccine front. Now, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration granted full approval to Pfizer and BioNTech's COVID-19 jabs in a move that could accelerate inoculations in the country. This development pushed the tech-heavy NASDAQ to an all-time high, jumping over 1.5%. The Dow also adding 200 points, while the S&P 500 advanced to 44.79. Shares of BioNTech gained, as well as rival Moderna. Surging crude prices driven by expected demand growth drove energy shares higher as well. Now, on the data front, sales of pre-owned homes unexpectedly rose in July, while a report from IHS Markit showed business activity in the U.S. accelerated this month.
The trend of the market is up. The experts, of which I'd like to think I'm one, are annoyed and even vexed by the fact that there hasn't been a significant downturn, a significant pullback in the market for quite a while. And we voice all the reasons why the market should go down. It keeps going up because the trend is your friend. Don't bet against the Fed. And for now, a placid, tepid economic backdrop is very good for stock prices. That's why today is a risk-on day. The economic pronouncements have been relatively disappointing if you're an economist. They've been quite pleasing if you're a stock trader.
Meanwhile, investors are eyeing the Jackson Hole Symposium later this week, which is expected to be a market-moving event where policymakers could detail their plans for tapering monetary stimulus. Taking a look now at U.S. stock futures, all major indices pointing to a higher open when trading resumes tonight, Manila time. Looking at other asset classes, Bitcoin's rebound taking a pause after surging past $50,000 on Monday. The world's largest cryptocurrency retreated to $49,000. The decline was predominantly driven by profit-taking. Still, Bitcoin has climbed 82% since hitting a yearly low of $27,000. Its rival, Ether, has also risen 91% since slumping below $1,740 last month. The cryptocurrency recovery comes as more established financial services companies offer their customers access to virtual coins. Among them, PayPal, which launched a platform in the UK, allowing customers to buy, sell, and hold cryptocurrencies. The rollout, which marks the first international expansion of PayPal's cryptocurrency services outside of the U.S., could inspire further mainstream adoption of the new asset class. Now, back here at home, the Philippines' biggest proposed budget yet is now up for congressional review. Lawmakers are expected to intensely scrutinize the government's spending plan, which an advocacy group believes fails to adequately address the COVID-19 pandemic. RG Cruz has the full story.
The Department of Budget and Management has submitted to the House of Representatives the proposed 5.024 trillion peso 2022 National Expenditure Program, the biggest budget in the country's history. President Duterte explained the government allocated money for COVID-19 booster shots, even if there is no final decision yet on whether or not it is necessary. There's also funding for personal protective equipment and other requirements for COVID-19 response, including research and development. The budget also provides aid for those who need it domestically and overseas, and earmarks funds for education and agriculture. But Albay Representative Edsel Lagman stresses the need to intensely scrutinize the budget. He says mere generic references or general attributions to appropriations are not enough. About 345 billion pesos is allotted for COVID-19 response, but even the DBM admits it's not the biggest item in the budget, even if there is a pandemic. Education, Public Works, and Interior and Local Government trump health budget-wise.
Ang health, kung titingnan mo ang budget, pang-apat pa rin ang Department of Health, no? Mm-hmm. Kasi under the constitution natin, ang pinakamalaki talaga is education sector.
Okay.
Tapos, oo, itinutuloy ng ating gobyerno yung flagship program niya na talagang build, build, build. Okay. So, number two ang DPWH. Plus, yung sa Interior, Department of Interior, eh, ang malaki lang naman dyan, although number three siya, ang malaki dyan dahil yun sa mga naka-uniforme, no? Yung kapulisan, mga taga Bureau of Fire, tsaka jail.
The president said about 1.18 trillion pesos will go to infrastructure spending next year. The DBM explains this amount will go to roads, flood management, and transportation. The Departments of Interior and Local Government and National Defense get over 200 billion pesos each. The controversial National Task Force to End Local Communist Armed Conflict will get a 28.1 billion peso budget in 2022. Almost 10 billion pesos higher than its budget this year. Despite criticisms, it has been used against government critics. About 1,400 barangays will supposedly benefit from its barangay development program. Bayan Muna wants the NTFL-CAC abolished and its funds realigned to vaccine purchases, mass testing, and contact tracing. Ibon Foundation says the 2022 budget is the second budget in a row that fails to respond to the pandemic. It says the Duterte administration is not spending enough to stimulate the economy and small businesses, which are the most important things to recover quickly. The House leadership sees intense debates. That's why it will talk to its members about their parochial concerns outside of budget deliberations. The deliberations will begin on Thursday. The House only has until September 30 to approve the budget on final reading. The House will ask the president to certify the bill as urgent to avoid a reenacted budget on election year. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippines poll body to look into concerns over a possible election supplier having links to Davao businessman Dennis Oy. Now, Oy was one of the largest campaign donors of President Rodrigo Duterte when he ran back in 2016. A Wall Street Journal profile listed Oy as the chairman of F2 Logistics, the lone firm qualified for the contract for the transportation of election supplies in next year's presidential elections. But Commission on Elections Chairman Sherif Abbas says there's still an ongoing post-qualification process before the contract can be awarded to that company.
Sabi ko tingnan ninyo yan kasi nga mainam din na maklaro natin. Pero sa initial na alam ko, hindi F2 but Pugo yung kanyang ownership. Hindi naman automatic yan na dahil contributor siya is qualified na siya. Alam naman natin na karamihan ng mga negosyante malalaki, nag-contribute naman yan kaysa iba't ibang mga upuan. So, hindi naman yan automatic.
Foreign chambers in the Philippines calling on the Senate to liberalize the telecommunications sector in a bid to foster competition and provide better service. They say they have some concerns over the recommendations of several senators to keep telco as a public utility during deliberations on the bill amending the Public Service Act. The group argues liberalizing the sector sends a strong signal that the Philippines is open to foreign investors. It adds, the move will also help improve the country's ranking by the Organization of Economic Cooperation and Development from its current placement as one of the most restrictive economies for foreign investment. Senate Bill 2094 limits the definition of public utilities to natural monopolies, such as electricity, water, and sewerage. Should the telco sector be retained as a public utility, it will be subject to a 40% limit on foreign ownership. Now, when you've got volatility everywhere, investors are now compelled to look at dividend plays, particularly dividend stocks. And for those looking to add or for an attractive exposure to dividends, your next guest could just have what you're looking for. Joining us now, Frederick Go, President and CEO of Robinson's Land and Chairman of RL Commercial REIT. Frederick, good morning. Thank you so much for joining us.
Good morning, Michelle.
Okay, so big news yesterday. 6.45 pesos per share for the RCR REIT IPO. Why did you go for the 12% discount from the price in the initial prospectus? Because, I mean, for context, the implied yield at this price is at 5.7%. You're somewhere in the middle of the pack. That's a bit higher than A-REIT's 5.2 and slightly lower than PhilREIT's 6.3% and DDMP. So why did you go for this price?
Well, first of all, Michelle, I'd just like to point out that our yield actually for next year, the estimated yield is actually 5.96%. No? It's slightly above the 5.7% that you mentioned. But, you know, the 7.31 pesos that we filed, that is really filed as a maximum up-to price. So it has really been normal standard practice to issue your shares at a discount to the maximum up-to price. And you're correct, there is a 12% discount to the maximum price. And I think it enhances the overall attractiveness of the offering to the investors. And we have been, I think, so far receiving some very good comments about it from the market. So we're quite happy about it.
Mm-hmm. What makes you confident about this REIT IPO, Frederick? I mean, the property sector isn't exactly the favorite or the darling during the pandemic, but what makes you bullish about this segment?
You know, Michelle, the office sector in the Philippines has really been driven by the BPO industry, the IT BPM industry for many years now, in fact, decades. This is really a once-in-a-generation opportunity. No, for our country to capitalize on. The BPO industry has really been growing leaps and bounds for many years. And even now, during the height of the pandemic, the BPO industry still continues to grow. We have a lot of, shall we say, anecdotal evidence of BPO companies continue to take up spaces, renewing spaces, and expanding even to the provinces. So we're very confident because this business so far has been very resilient. We've been through a lot of crisis, no? Local crisis, global crisis, and yet the BPO industry has always proven resilient.
And this strength from this industry also supported your performance this year. Property players, including Robinson's Land, of course, saw a pretty decent bounce back this year. Your second quarter numbers actually quadrupled, bringing your first half profit to jump 48%.
I think I froze.
Does your anti-dandruff shampoo make your hair dry?
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Welcome back to Market Edge. Apologies for the technical difficulties there, but we are still joined by Mr. Frederick Goh. He is the chairman, of course, of the RL Commercial REIT, and he is at the helm of Robinson's Land. Let's pick it up from the second question there, Frederick. You've got a pretty decent bounce back this year, but then you've got the Delta variant, renewed lockdowns, rising cases. And of course, let's not forget, for the first half, you did see a low base effect, so the jump would really be higher. How much more difficult do you think is it going to be to sustain the momentum from the first half into the second half?
Well, Michelle, you know, it's really challenging. This pandemic has really been challenging, I think, for almost all the industries. But what gives us a lot of confidence and encouragement is, you know, last year, at the height of the pandemic, of the first lockdown, so to speak, you know, we were totally caught off guard. We were totally unprepared for this event. We did not know what to do. We did not know how to prepare. We did not know how to counter this. But, you know, a year and a half later, the government's vaccination program is now in full force. There's a lot of hope that a lot of the citizens, especially in the National Capital Region, will reach herd immunity within the year. And we now know how to counter this virus. We know how to do contact tracing, social distancing, sanitation, hygiene, and proper protection for ourselves, no? Through various types of PPEs. So we're very confident that if we were resilient then when we did not know anything, we think that we are even more resilient now that we know at least what we are facing and how to protect ourselves. And of course, I cannot overstress the vaccination program. No, I think that's really the solution to all of this. And the global companies, the global pharmaceutical companies, I'm sure are working overtime to develop better and better vaccines for everyone.
Speaking of the vaccination program, are you vaccinating your people?
Well, thank you for asking. At Robinson's Land, 95% of our people are already vaccinated. So we've taken this very seriously. We've spared no effort to really promote vaccination. So here at our head office, here in the NCR, we're 95% vaccinated.
But these are for your regular employees, not your agents.
That's right. The 95% number would be for our regular employees. We're now moving towards... shall we say, the other non-direct employees of the company, they will also be vaccinated very soon.
Wow. Okay, that's great news, Frederick. So clearly, you've been very busy this year versus last year. But you know, last year was really horrible in terms of people, you know, vacating their spaces, getting out. But where do you stand today versus 2 years ago, before the pandemic hit? Are people and companies still looking at spaces again?
Yes, Michelle. You know, we have so many businesses, no, under Robinson's Land. We actually have 8 businesses. Mm-hmm. So I'd say 6 out of the 8 are doing extremely well. Our residential business is selling very well. Our land and house products are hitting record highs. Our offices also continue to get very good traction. The BPO companies continue to grow. Our industrial and logistics facilities continue to get leased out very quickly, mm-hmm, as we build them. Our integrated developments also, like our Bridgetown Destination Estate, continues to attract a lot of attention from the largest players, no, in the region and in the Philippines. So a lot of our businesses actually are doing very well.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay. And you mentioned 6 out of 8. The two, yes. Who are the weak links?
Well, yeah, they would be the shopping malls. I think it needs no further explanation. Mm-hmm. And the other business that's also suffering right now would be our hotels, our hospitality business. Mm-hmm. As you can imagine, the travel restrictions have obviously not been good for the hospitality business.
Okay. I'm very curious, Frederick. I know you're in the inner circle of the JG Group. You're a member of the family as well. When executives of the JG Summit Group gather around to talk the big picture, what are some of the new trends that you're seeing and that you're expecting to see in consumer behavior, in the way we do things, in lifestyle changes post-pandemic? Do you think there will be significant changes that will stick or that, you know, this is a temporary thing, we'll most likely go back to the way we were before the pandemic hit?
Yeah, the one answer I can give you is digitalization. No? The digitalization of commerce, the digitalization of the way we do things, I think has been hastened a lot during this pandemic, and I think it is here to stay. I think that people will always look for easier ways of doing things, no? And digitalization, whether it's e-commerce or processes or whatever you can think of, there's a lot, right? Bookings, communication, like what we're doing now, electronic meetings. I think those will be here to stay, no? Of course, when the market recovers, people like to be with people. People want to have direct relationships, direct communication with people. So, of course, a lot of that will come back. But still, the simplification of the way we do things through digital means, I think, will be a trend that is unstoppable.
It's Ms. Lisa Gokongwei who's heading the digitalization effort, right? So you must be working very closely with her.
That's right. She's the boss for digitalization.
You know, speaking of digitalization, Frederick, I just have to mention, I'm sure you know Rosie. Rosie is the digital shopper for your malls. I've actually tried transacting with her several times, and I love the experience. At one time, I had to return and exchange some items. She was very accommodating.
Yeah, my wife loves Rosie too.
And for those who need, you know, items for men, there's also a guy. Is it Romeo?
Rob.
There, Rob and Rosie. Yes, yes. Okay, so wonderful experience there. Given all of these insights that you just mentioned, digitalization, and of course the bullishness that you have, how aggressive are you pursuing land banking at this point? I know that you mentioned you're very bullish about the office space. I understand this year you're going to be ending with 721,000 square meters of leasable office space. That's up 18% this year. Next year, you're looking to grow another 7%. Your goal is to hit 1 million square meters by 2025. So what sort of land banking are you looking at? Will it only be here in the Philippines, or will China be included? Because you do have projects in China.
Yeah. Well, thank you for mentioning our China business. That's doing very well. But I think our goals for 2022 are clearly for the Philippines. You know, based on the REIT law, Michelle, we're raising roughly around 23.5 billion pesos. No?
Mm-hmm.
Based on the REIT law, we have to deploy all of that capital within 365 days and in the Philippines. So Robinson's Land will be deploying that capital into land banking, as you mentioned, as well as the development of more offices, residential buildings, industrial and logistics facilities, building more destination estates, et cetera, et cetera. So land banking will always be a part of our life. And we are, at any moment in time, always exploring opportunities. No, we're always looking at land acquisitions, whether in Metro Manila or in the provinces. So as you know, we're truly a nationwide company. We have operations in at least 80 cities and municipalities throughout the country. So we are what you call a true nationwide Philippine real estate company.
Mm-hmm. Okay, very bullish there. Frederick, I wanted to end with this question. You've been with Robinson's Land since 1992, but very few know that you actually started your career as a journalist for the Manila Times. You were writing the business news at a time when your uncle, Big John Gokongwei, was, I understand, looking to buy that company. So now when you look at the business headlines, what do you think do the business headlines get wrong today? Or are we possibly missing when we look at the news that, I mean, you have a view from the inside and from the top. What are we getting wrong? What are we possibly missing whenever we do the business headlines? I'm very curious.
Michelle, that's a really tough question. I'm totally not prepared to answer the question. But I think the business headlines are pretty good. I think the generations have become better and better. I think the journalists today are much better than I was.
But okay, I guess I want to push you a bit on that. Do you think that we're getting it right, when we write these headlines, that we have the correct perspective, or not correct, not even correct. We're having the same perspective as the leaders of the industries, like yourselves. Are we seeing it the same way as you? Or are you seeing it slightly different?
I guess it's slightly different, no? I think as a journalist, you're always looking for an angle, no? An angle to promote the story, right? But I guess business sometimes can be boring, so you can just tell it the way it is, but it probably won't sell. So journalists have to find an angle to the story, and that's always the challenge, right? That's where the creativity comes out. That's where the ability of the journalist comes out. So I think it's all good. I think business headlines today are all good.
Okay, on that note, Frederick, thank you so much for joining us this morning. It's a pleasure to finally speak with you, and good luck with the REIT. Offer period begins tomorrow, August 26th, right?
Well, August pending 25? Regulatory approvals. Yeah, we're hoping to start tomorrow, August 25. Thank you so much, Michelle. We really appreciate this time Market Edge has given us. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Frederick. See you soon. Stay safe. Okay, now here are some economic data releases we're monitoring today. Tuesday, Germany will announce its final second quarter growth figures. Now, initial estimates showed Germany's GDP grew by 9.2% in the April to June period after posting five consecutive periods of contraction due to the pandemic. And South Africa will post its second quarter jobs numbers. Now, South Africa's unemployment rate rose to 32.6% in the first 3 months of the year, the highest jobless rate since comparable data began in 2008. The Philippines reporting a new record high of daily COVID-19 cases. The health department recorded 18,332 new coronavirus cases on Monday. Now, this raises the number of active infections to 130,350. That is the highest since April 19th. 151 people also died. The grim figures come as the Philippine Genome Center confirmed the detection of 466 more carriers of the highly contagious Delta COVID-19 variant, majority of which are local cases. Nearly half of them live in Metro Manila, while dozens of others are in Central Luzon, Western Visayas, and Calabarzon. A health official believes community transmission of the Delta variant may have already been observed in two regions. Philippine business groups are growing frustrated over repeated lockdowns in the country. They point out cases are still rising to new records, adding the response should be focused on strengthening the healthcare system.
Sinulat din namin last year pa na huwag pabayaan na hindi na yung mga hospital kailangan tuloy-tuloy ang pagdagdag ng kwarto dahil pag nagkaroon ng surge. Huwag din pabayaan na yung mga frontliners natin hindi maalagaan. Nangyari?
Tayo, nakailan lockdown tayo, ang ating sistema pare-pareho at hindi nakikita natututo. Ang nilarason lang, napupuno ang mga hospital. Yung mga facilities, kumukulang.
Still, government officials defend recent hard lockdowns in the country, saying they worked to a certain degree. Up next, a look at how Asian markets are doing with Ken Wong of East Spring Investments Market Edge. We'll be right back.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Start of the week right now, the PSEI opening higher by 0.6%, 66.31. But the question is, can we stay up? Because yesterday we also started up but ended down. We're going to be speaking with Ken Wong of East Spring Investments for an outlook on Asian markets. And Philippine business groups say repeated lockdowns in the country are failing to curb the ongoing spike in COVID-19 cases. And we're going to take a closer look at the financial mindset of younger Filipinos amid the pandemic with Melissa Henson of Manulife Philippines. U.S. Vice President Kamala Harris wraps up her visit in Singapore with a stop at the Changi Naval Base to meet American troops. She also toured the USS Tulsa combat ship. Now, during her Singapore visit, Harris reaffirmed America's commitment to a free and open South China Sea. The city-state is home to the biggest port in Southeast Asia and supports free navigation in the area.
Our presence in the Indo-Pacific has a long, long history, including now, of helping to guarantee peace and security, freedom of trade and commerce, freedom of navigation. I'm going to say that again. Freedom of navigation and open waterways and the rules-based international order that has brought so much safety and prosperity to so many. It is in our vital interest to stand united with our allies and our partners in Southeast Asia in defense of a free and open Indo-Pacific. Free and open.
The U.S. and Singapore also agreeing to expand cybersecurity cooperation in the financial sector and the military during Harris's visit. They also struck partnerships to fight COVID-19 and climate change. Harris heads to Vietnam today, becoming the first U.S. vice president to visit that country since 1975. A look now at Asian markets. Stocks in the region are trading higher this morning as optimism rises over the full approval of Pfizer and BioNTech's COVID-19 vaccines in the U.S. South Korea's KOSPI Index, as you can see, up by over 1%. Markets in Japan and Australia also in the green. Turning now very quickly to some interesting corporate stories from the region, Chinese e-commerce giant JD.com beating earnings estimates, defying China's tech crackdown. It posted sales of 253.8 billion yuan or $39.1 billion in the second quarter, better than the 248.5 billion yuan forecast. The company also added a record 32 million users over the quarter and delivered growth in its logistics and marketplace divisions. Meanwhile, Chinese ride-hailing giant Didi Chuxing has suspended its plans to launch in Britain and continental Europe due to the ongoing regulatory backlash in Beijing. Now, Didi has stopped hiring in the UK, pulling the launch plans for at least a year. Chinese companies have been caught in the middle of an increasing U.S. scrutiny and a domestic regulatory crackdown in China's massive tech sector. Joining us today for his take on Asian markets, Ken Wong of East Spring Investments. Of course, East Spring Investments is a member of the Prudential Group in the UK. Ken, good morning. Great to have you back.
Morning.
Okay, so give us a sense. I mean, when you talk to investors, when you do your reports, what are investors looking for today and where are you finding it these days?
Yeah, right now, a lot of investors, you know, especially over the past month or so, have had a lot of negative sentiment over China. You know, as you reported earlier, some of the Chinese tech companies have, started to report. We saw Tencent reporting last week. JD reported earlier. And, you know, the numbers were actually ahead of consensus. You know, the fact is that, you know, while a lot of this negative sentiment started towards the beginning of the third quarter in July, at least what we saw during the first half of the year is that a lot of the earnings are still very strong. A lot of the investors right now are concerned is, you know, given the correction that we've seen, especially within China right now, is this now a good time to invest? Because the markets have, when you look at some of the stock markets, for instance, the Hang Seng Index just last week was sort of more into the bear territory. You know, we've seen corrections of 15, 20, 25% for some of the major indices. And the fact is that, you know, because investors are still somewhat concerned and a bit skeptical as to what's going on, they're still waiting to see specifically whether or not there's going to be better entry points.
Okay. Before we get to the details of the markets, we did get a raft of PMIs, manufacturing PMIs yesterday. You've got Japan's, for example, factory activity growth slowing in August. Japan's services sector shrank at the fastest pace since May last year. Australia's manufacturing PMI also falling to a 14-month low. And the Eurozone preliminary PMIs missed estimates for August, although it's still growing.
Yep.
All of the data seem to point to the increasingly heavy toll that the recent wave of COVID-19 infections is taking on the global economy. How much are you expecting the Delta variant to derail market performance?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because the fact is that, you know, expectation when you look at markets were very high in the beginning of the year, and even, you know, just a few months ago when it looks like a lot of the economies were opening up. But then over the past few months, you know, with the spread of the Delta variant, we've seen how some economies have started to be back on a semi-lockdown again. Overall international trade has started to slow down slightly. International travel has started to slow again because of the result of, you know, what's happening. So all in all, you know, this is not, you know, something that we didn't expect with the rise in the Delta cases. But I think it's going to be important to see, especially for the corporates themselves. You know, as we approach, you know, sort of the end of the third quarter, and, you know, as we approach the fourth quarter and into 2022, what's the expectations going forward for a lot of these companies? And that's why we're right in the middle of the reporting season right now. So a lot of companies right now that we're meeting with are, you know, telling us what they're expecting for at least for the next few months. And then what are also their CapEx plans, you know, where they're going to spend their, you know, sort of capital expenditures in 2022 and beyond. And those are going to be really the key facts.
You know, Ken, it's all about really setting the expectations. You overpromise and then underdeliver, the investors are going to go crazy. But if you underpromise and overdeliver, you make them very happy. So what are the expectations? What's the consensus on expectations moving
right now
over the next two quarters?
Yeah, I think right now for a lot of the cyclical stocks, you know, those tend to move in a slightly better position right now. You know, especially just overall sentiment towards some of the maybe new economy stocks or maybe some of the tech stocks, especially in China, those tend to still be, you know, sort of quite negative sentiment. But the fact is, when it comes to investing, you know, you don't always want to be, you know, buying those stocks that everybody's, you know, just pushing for constantly. And you want to also look for some of those opportunities where stocks are trading well below their intrinsic value. So that's kind of where we're at. But all in all, you know, just when we look at earnings as a whole and expectations right now throughout Asia, and particularly when we look at China as a whole, you know, old economy cyclical stocks are tending to still be on a slightly more upward trajectory when it comes to positive earnings revisions. While when you look at new economy stocks, especially the internet related, the education related throughout China, those tend to still be, you know, quite, I would say, a negative sort of environment right now.
You mentioned China several times already today. There is a thesis among some big brokerage houses that amid the crackdown, the regulatory crackdown, a slowing recovery momentum for China, it seems that China is uninvestable at this point. The risks, the regulatory risks are just too high. Do you agree?
It depends on where you invest within China, right? The fact is that when you look at China, there's a number of different stock markets. When we look at the domestic A shares in Shanghai and Shenzhen, there's very little internet-related or, you know, education-related stocks. So the overall exposure there is 0.1%. And then when you look at, you know, the Hong Kong-listed ones or the U.S.-listed ones, those are much bigger, right? The exposure there are for internet as well as education is roughly 25 to 30%. So there's a lot more exposure there. So I would say, you know, you can still be very much invested in certain segments right now within the A-shares and, you know, look for opportunities when it comes to, you know, sort of some of the stocks listed here in Hong Kong or in the U.S. because, you know, they're still very strong stocks. As you reported earlier, you know, earnings still, you know, is still coming fairly solid for at least some of the heavyweights. And so, you know, let's see specifically what's going to happen, because the fact is that, you know, China is still a very strong economy. There's still a lot of, you know, need for consumption of products.
You did come out with a recent report on China's approach to ESG.
Yeah.
Are you bullish about ESG stocks or names in China?
Yeah, the fact is that when you look at, you know, what China's trying to do, especially on the E side, right, they've been really trying to be, you know, sort of making that push towards carbon neutral. They're one of the leaders mm-hmm. when it comes to electric vehicles. When we look at solar power, these are things that, you know, China, renewable energy, these are things that China are doing, you know, sort of, you know, at the forefront. Then specifically when we talk about the S, I think right now, you know, when we talk about, you know, sort of a lot of these regulations right now on the tech sector or specifically on the education sector, you know, this is one of the ways that China is tackling the yes part, I would say. So all in all, you know, there's definitely some opportunities there. And, you know, for us, you know, it is finding those companies that we feel will be ESG leaders going forward in China.
Ah, interesting take there. Looking at the bigger picture for EMs, for emerging markets, Ken, you've got the likes of Goldman Sachs, Bank of America, the Lazard Asset Management. They're very bullish and really betting big on EM equity, saying that the lost decade of emerging markets post the global financial crisis of 2008, which left EMs at what, 20-year lows versus developed nation stocks, that lost decade is almost over. They're saying we're cheap, vaccinations are catching up, and we're benefiting from a commodity boom cycle. And not even China's regulatory crackdown could temper that. Do you agree? Are you more bullish on EM stocks now versus the developed stocks or those stocks from the Europe or from the US?
Yeah, certainly. The fact is that, like you mentioned earlier, you know, it's been, I wouldn't say the last decade, and there's still a lot that's gone on over the past decade. But when you look at it from an overall performance standpoint, no doubt, right, U.S. equity markets have definitely outperformed over the past 10 years. But when we look at overall valuations, U.S. equity markets now are trading, what, 23, 24 times forward earnings. Then when we look at emerging markets, they're sort of hovering around, you know, 15, 16 times forward earnings at a price to book of just a little bit north of two times book. While when we look at the U.S. is roughly about 4.5 times price to book. So you're definitely much more attractive when it comes to valuations in the EM. And of course, because we had a strong rising dollar, you know, over the past decade or so, where U.S. dollar had, you know, fairly solid strength after the GFC, that also created some negative sentiment as well towards emerging markets. But overall, when we look at economic growth, when we look at specifically, you know, sort of the rising consumption demand for a lot of countries within the emerging markets, that's really going to be key drivers for the emerging markets for years and years to come. So yeah, we're absolutely in the same position where we definitely do like emerging markets for the opportunities that it presents itself.
I know that among the favorites among EMs would be Brazil, Mexico, and Russia. But what about the Philippines, Ken? What's your call on the Philippine market? Do you like us? Don't you like us? And why?
Yeah,
because the last time we had you, you were saying that, you know, we like Philippines, but you've gone up so much so soon. We've since corrected a little bit from those levels, 7,000 back in July. So how do you find us today?
Yeah, I think specifically when we look at valuations now, they look more attractive again. You know, the fact is that, you know, given the correction that we saw quite sharply as well that we saw in July, you know, it's one of those situations now. It's definitely something that we're looking at. You know, the fact is that, you know, with the lockdowns does not help. Obviously, you know, the fact is that, you know, with the lockdowns, that does definitely deteriorate some of the economic activity that's going on. and, you know, uncertainty over, you know, specifically, you know, global trades and, you know, specifically what's going on overseas, that potentially has an impact on overall remittance back into the Philippines. So that creates some concerns. But at the end of the day, you know, I think with your earlier guests, with some of the new IPOs coming, you know, sort of on board, the fact is that, you know, investor sentiment could definitely start to improve, especially if we start to see, you know, sort of more stocks, you know, sort of listing and the demand for those particular stocks increase. So there is definitely that appetite there. But of course, you know, needing to attract some of that foreign capital to come back into the Philippines is definitely where, you know, where we would feel more comfortable. And obviously, you know, with more stocks, you know, sort of listing, that could potentially be a catalyst.
Okay, on that optimistic note, Ken, thank you so much for joining us. Always a pleasure to get your insights. Stay safe. Now, here is a rundown of some corporate stories here at home. Again, just before we go to the corporate stories, the PSEI opening higher by about 0.6% today. We're also covering some interesting stories. Let's start with Santa Lucia Land, SLI, posting a 90% jump in the first half profit to 1.4 billion pesos. They're saying that income tax expenses were lower because of the CREATE law, and that also helped offset higher costs. Santa Lucia Land has 115 ongoing projects, 60 of which are located in high growth area of Calabarzon, 25 in Davao, and the others spread out in other regions. That's Santa Lucia Land. Now we have from Land Bank, saying that this is, of course, a government-controlled bank. They've onboarded 4.5 million unbanked Filipinos in the recent period. Here's an interesting one. Good news for Philippine Airlines shareholders. PAL actually cut losses in the first half of this year by 21% to 16.6 billion pesos. How did they do that? Sweeping cost-cutting measures. They're also delaying new aircraft deliveries. They ended last year, with 95 new aircraft versus 97 the year before. So that's for PAL. And we have this from Manila Mining Corporation. It's actually set to resume exploration drilling into the Caudal Norte following the exploration of gold-rich copper resource below their previous mine. They're going to be spending 350 million pesos for a 2 to 3 year exploration program. The U.S. Federal Reserve came up with a very interesting report that actually said millennials are the biggest but the poorest generation. In the U.S. at least, millennials, those who are born between 1981 and 1996, make up nearly a quarter of the U.S. population, but they own a scant 3% of the country's wealth. When baby boomers were the age that millennials are today, they actually controlled 21% of the national wealth. Assuming this is the trend across the globe, including the Philippines or Asia, how has the pandemic changed the financial mindsets of the young? Joining us this morning, Melissa Henson, Senior Vice President and Chief Marketing Officer of Manulife Philippines. Hi, Melissa. Great to have you back.
Hi, Mimi. Good morning. Thank you for having me.
Okay, great to have you. So very interesting stuff here. How has the pandemic, you think, changed the financial mindset, the priorities, and the habits of the Gen Zs and the Gen Ys? And just for context, Gen Zs are known as the Zoomers. They're born from the mid to late 1990s and until the early 2010s. The Gen Ys are the millennials. I guess that's you and me. We were born between 1981 and 1994 or 1996. So talk to us about the shift caused by the pandemic.
Sure. So this is something we wanted to look at because, of course, our pandemic has been going on now for 18 months. And when we looked last year at how Filipinos in general were feeling, we looked at their attitudes more about physical health, and we realized that that's very much related to financial health. So since this has persisted for so long, we wanted to come back this year and understand how the prolonged disruption is affecting Filipinos, specifically this time from a financial health perspective, and also zooming in on Gen Z and the millennials, because for the Philippines, they actually make up about 70% of our population. So this is majority of our population. They are our future leaders and future drivers of socioeconomic change. And if you think about it, they are at phases in their lives when they would be moving through some significant life changes. And it's all happening in the context of this pandemic. You know, Gen Z coming into the workforce, millennials settling down, all of that is happening in this context. So we wanted to understand what the pandemic has done to them. And actually, you know, these generations, because they have grown up in a hyper-digitized world, are known as instant gratification generations, because they grew up in a time of economic prosperity for the Philippines, actually, and much of the world. They're also known to be very optimistic. But actually, you know, the pandemic has been a game changer for both of these generations. And to use, I guess, terminology that's very common, it sped up their adulting, especially from a financial perspective. So what we're finding based on our survey is that there's much higher awareness now about spending on necessities rather than wants. Saving has actually become a top priority. And when we ask why they save, you know, their biggest concern is running out of money during this time, during the pandemic. And when we ask why they say, you know, I save because something might happen to me. So in case something happens to me, I want to make sure that I have savings. And there are also very, very future focused savings objectives. So it's about saving so they can start a new business one day, saving so they can save for their family's needs in the future. So those who are starting families, they want to be sure they have money for education. They want to save so they can be sure they have money for retirement. So very future focused. And I think very different from the usual perception of these generations. And again, a lot of it is because of the changes, I think, that we've gone through during the pandemic. There's a segment that has experienced reduction in income. So they're very much aware that they have less funds available to them now. Some have experienced job loss. So they know that the job market during the pandemic is very different from what it was before that. So all of these things have really contributed to a shift in their financial mindset.
So these are insights from the report that you're releasing today about the Ys and the Zs. These are the takeaways, of course. Yeah, there we go. We're actually flashing some of the infographics and the findings. I'm very curious, though. You say that, you know, this generation are spending more on necessities now. Their saving has become more of a priority. They have very future-focused saving objectives. Is this generation also more risky compared to the others, you think?
Actually, when we dove into their investment strategy, because what we found is 77% have told us that they're focused more on necessities, but we also looked into how they're saving, how they're investing. Between Gen Z and millennials, millennials are a bit more mature in terms of their financial literacy because they've been earning for longer, they've been in the workforce longer. And when we asked about investment approaches, investment strategies, it's also a rather long-term view. They talk to us about balancing risk and protection and diversifying their portfolios to make sure that they're not putting too many eggs in one basket and they're managing risks in that way. So 67% of millennials have said they're investing. They track, actually, there's a segment that tracks their portfolio religiously and make sure they look at their assets and liabilities and they're on track.
Wow. And all, part of the infographics, I hope we can show this, would be the top financial products owned by millennials and Gen Zs. 79% for millennials said they have insurance. That's the highest. And for the Gen Zs, the highest is also, wow, insurance as well, 68%. So far, the one that got the lowest would be mutual funds, 38% millennials, 33% for Gen Zs. And wow, cryptocurrencies is in the middle of the pack, 60% millennials and 40% Gen Zs. Very quickly, Melissa, this, you know, what kind of labor market is assumed by the generations in your report. I mean, you've got unemployment still high at 7.7% as of June, underemployment at 14.2%. This is how they're going to make money, and they will need money to make investments. So what are the assumptions on the labor market that these millennials and Gen Zs have, you think?
We actually didn't look at any specific industry when we were sourcing for our survey. We sourced based on age, generation, all over the country. So we actually have responders, not just from Manila, but also various cities across Visayas, Mindanao, and upwards across Luzon. So it's a cross-section of the youth of our country. For Gen Z, we focused specifically because the age range is actually about 9 years old to 24. So for this survey, we primarily looked at 15 years old to 24. So about a good portion, about maybe half of the Gen Z that we spoke with are still in school and are still looking to enter the labor market in the future. So no specific industries that we looked at. I think the sentiments broadly give us a hint of what our young Filipinos are thinking about during this time.
And I imagine looking at Generation Alpha would also be interesting. These are those born, you know, in the early 2010s and the mid 2020s. Most of them are kids of the millennials. Looking forward to more insights from Manulife. Thank you so much, Melissa, for joining us this morning and for the insights.
Thank you, Mimi.
Okay, and that is it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. You can listen to our interviews again on the ANC Market Edge podcast, available on Spotify. Stay safe and stay with ANC.